This video is brought to you by us. Check out tubedavinci.com, our website, for full in-depth write-ups and analysis of all the topics we talk about. And in the future, we're going to have solar calculators and EV calculators, all kinds of cool stuff, all coming soon. tubedavinci.com. Hi, I'm Ricky, and I'm on a mission to build a net zero house, which means making our own electricity, ditching natural gas, and eventually making our own water. So today we're talking about electricity and staying cool this summer and saving some money. So in San Diego, it's officially summertime, and all of a sudden, after a very cool spring, it's getting really hot. So I thought, how about we make a video talking about some of the interesting ways we're gonna try to stay cool and save money this summer. Let's go. All right, so one of the first things you should always be thinking about in terms of staying cool is a ceiling fan. Here is an example of what we have in our studio. Without that fan, it would be too hot in here for me to record. And the reason why a fan is so great is because it works no matter where you live. In fact, most of the world doesn't have air conditioning and they opt for ceiling fans. So right now, even if the room was 85 degrees, which is really hot, if there was a fan running and moving air over your skin, you'd feel okay. Whereas you turn that fan off and you'll start sweating because the air right by your skin starts warming up and you'll start sweating and feeling uncomfortable. So to stay cool this summer, the first thing you probably want to invest in is some stuff to measure heat. So let's start with the cheapest thing. This is a company called SwitchBot. I got these because they tell you the humidity and the temperature, and a four pack of these is only about $35. Next up, you can get one of these. This is an IR kind of laser temperature gauge. So it'll tell you how hot things are. So it's about 80 degrees in this room, which is not particularly cold, but this is pretty cool. You can kind of get an idea of how hot things are just from a distance, and that can come in handy. And if you want to take your game to the next level, then you can get an infrared camera like this. This is a FLIR Pro, and this attaches to your phone and gives you really cool images that you can record and take a look at. Here's something really cool, by the way. You want to be a little mini detective. If I step on this floor, I'm going to be heating it, and if I step away, you can still see my footprint. Next up is windows. I have double pane windows, but if you see here, they're really old. They're like first generation double pane windows. So as a result, the heat comes right through here, especially this window. When the sun rises, it feels like you're in like a tanning bed or something. It's really bad. So I got this. This is a window film. It says it has like a titanium layer and it's supposed to block the sun's heat. It says it rejects 72% of the sun's heat and 99% of UV rays. So here's what it looks like, by the way. Can you see that? It has a very reflective kind of look. Step one, we'll clean the window. This is like a soap solution to help with the installation. I'm horrible at this. This is gonna turn out very poorly. I think my dreams of starting a window tinting service are shattering before my eyes. You got it? We need new windows at some point, but for a house like this, it's about $24,000 and we're not gonna do that anytime soon. So for now, we thought, for 50 bucks, how well does this perform? So this piece here has it installed, this piece doesn't. And I wanna show you how this looks on the FLIR camera. The window is much hotter, it's 108 degrees compared to 93. So about 15 degrees hotter on the window. On the floor, it's 96 degrees where there's no film and 87 degrees, about 9 degrees cooler. And you can actually really tell. If you stand here compared to stand here, big difference, about 10 degrees. So you might be thinking, how does this work? Well, this film gets hot and prevents that heat from coming forward. But this is hot and so now it's gonna radiate heat as well. This would only work if that means that the outside of the window was also hotter. Let's go take a look at that. Okay, on the outside of the window, it's the same story. It's about 109 on this glass that has the film and 96, so about 13 degrees hotter on the outside of the glass.
Yeah, this window is way hotter.
So that heat is transferring back through the gap in between the panes of glass to the outside and then back out. So then as the wind hits it, it'll take that heat out. This stuff works really well, but would I recommend it? It depends on how good you are with installing this film. It's a little bit finicky, right? You have to have a clean room and clean it and hold it up and cut and all that kind of stuff. So if that's the kind of thing that you're willing to do,
for $50, you could really keep the heat rejection out of your house from all your windows. And honestly, if you want to make it easier, just do the part facing the sun. So here, this is the south part of our house. So we're just going to put the film on the south facing windows. Pretty easy way to keep some of that heat out in the summer. So if you've ever wondered why homes are hot even at night when it's cooled off, well, your entire attic is hot and it stays hot for quite a while. So as a result, that heat radiates down into the main house, and that's why you want blown insulation and whatever else you can to prevent that. So speaking of hot attics, there's two things you can do to tackle that. And both are fairly cheap. The first is gable fans. So if you look around your house, you probably have gable attic ports. And if you get a fan on one of them, you can blow in fresh air and blow all that hot air out of the attic, keeping your attic cooler. If you do that, the wood and all the other parts in the attic will be cooler and radiate less heat down into your house. The second thing I mentioned, obviously, is insulation. And the third is a whole house fan. So this is something I had in my previous house, and I loved it. I use it all the time. So what a whole house fan does is it takes all the air in your house and blows it up into your attic. Then the attic gets pressurized and it pushes all that hot air out through the vents and cools your attic as well. Our current house, we don't have a whole house fan just yet, but I think as the summer has officially kicked in, we need to start to do that. Next up, let's talk about an evaporative cooler.
It's heavy, not that heavy, liftable.
Evaporative coolers come in all kinds of sizes. They even make little tiny ones that are kind of for your face, but this is a massive 2000 square foot house size fan. So if you look up close here, if you get in here, you'll see these are the little grills that the water will trickle down. And so the idea is to have a lot of surface area, and as the water goes over these coils, some of it will evaporate, cooling the air and giving you nice cold air on the inside. So this is the outside of the unit, and this is the inside. This was about, $660 at Home Depot. And let's try to get it installed in this window right here.
Yep.
And lower. All the way over, right? Okay. I just want to see how strong this fan is. So this is not exactly how you're supposed to install this, because you're supposed to have a vertical window, but we just put two pieces of wood, offset it a little bit, so there's a lip on this side to catch this, and this lip should go into the window. Let's see how we did. Cool. So we're not out of the woods yet. Cool idea, right? One? And the beautiful look, very shabby chic. My wife is all about that, I think. Woo, it feels cool. I'm freezing. And the water part's not even running yet. All right, let's go do that, Brim. So with this piece, it'll hold this ledge from collapsing. There we go. And perfect. Wait. Boom. That just happened. Now there's more suction. All right, so here's an anemometer. It actually has the wind speed and temperature. It's 87 degrees outside, which is pretty warm, and it's not especially windy. So let's fill this up, because after all, it is an evaporative cooler. Brim, water. It actually is supposed to be filled at this port, but I don't have that connection just yet, so we'll fill it up here. All right, so now we have water. Let's get back inside and see how much cooling effect we actually get. So the way an evaporative cooler works is it cycles water through those little coils you saw back there to slowly evaporate some of that water, and as a result, taking water from liquid to gaseous form absorbs energy. And as a result, the air in that area cools off really quickly as it comes through. But to put all that to practice, let's figure this out. We have 85 degree temperatures in here right now and about 47% humidity, relative humidity. And the reason I'm checking the humidity is because this is going to make the room more humid. But let's go ahead and let's try this out. And here's a FLIR camera recording. You can see we're looking at about 82 degrees in the fan area. So now let's see if I can turn it on remotely. I can. Okay, so this is just fan mode. The wind speed is about 3 meters per second, even out here. It's kind of cool, right? But you can see that the air is not any colder, and that's because, well, we're just moving the air that's outside and bring it in here. But it still feels good to the skin for the reason any fan does. Now let's go to cool mode. You see the turning blue? The fan area is turning blue. So if you look here now, we're at 77 degrees. And you can see that the surrounding room is warmer than the fan area. And the motor is right there in the middle, and that's why that's a little bit warmer. And should I go to high speed? Let's get crazy. Yeah, hey, look at that, 74. We'll go to high speed. The ambient air was 80. I think we started at 81. So we've dropped 8 degrees. Brim, check it out. Look at how blue, look at how dark that area is.
Oh, man.
It is 9 degrees colder right now. All right, we'll come back in 10 minutes, let's say.
The reason why this is popular is because it's way less electricity than air conditioning. So my air conditioning runs on about 4,500 watts, 4.5 kilowatts, right? This runs on 400 watts, 1/10 of the power. But now this requires water as well. How much? Well, on low, about 2 gallons an hour, and on high, about 4 gallons an hour. 4 gallons of water you have to supply, it'll evaporate, and that moisture comes into the house. Let me show you something here. All right, using this little SwitchBot thermostat and moisture meter, humidity meter, I have some data that I wanna show you real quick. So yesterday, around 11 o'clock, the house right here in this section got to 84.5 degrees. And once we turned the evaporative cooler on, it sank to 73 degrees in about 30 minutes, which is pretty amazing. But the problem is in that same period, the humidity went from 30% to 60%. You can think of the air as a big sponge. And as there's more water in the air, its potential for holding more water decreases. And as a result, it can't evaporate as much. And once that happens, it becomes very humid indoors and the cooling effect is largely neutralized. Also, I touched the floors and the carpets and rugs. It was kind of damp, which is the scary part. Here in San Diego, we don't have mold issues because it's pretty dry. But the minute you introduce that kind of humidity, you've got that Miami problem where mold can start to grow. So that's the one reason why I'm on the fence about this thing. It does work really well. And depending on where you live, if you live in the high desert, it might work for you. Also, if you want to mitigate some of those problems, you can turn the cooling on and off. Turn it on, cool the temperatures, and then as soon as it's colder outside, turn the water element off and just run it as a fan. And that fan will push air back in and kind of bring the humidity back down. So there's a very clear picture here. You're basically trading temperature for humidity. That's what you're doing. So if you live in Miami or you live in Hawaii, humid areas, this won't work because there's no more capacity in the air for extra water. So as a result, nothing will evaporate and it won't work very well. But if you live in Las Vegas or San Diego, somewhere arid and dry, one of these can save you a ton of money. Like I said, it's about 1/10 the electricity to run. Also, if you wanted, you could run on one of these for a couple of hours and then turn on your air conditioning, which will take the humidity back out of the air and kind of cycle back and forth between the two. So if that makes sense for you, it makes sense, which is cool. But in San Diego, with our water shortages and our droughts, do we really want to be spending 4 gallons an hour to run one of these? I don't know. I think once we have solar panels, I would just run my air conditioning and run it on solar and not do one of these. But this is something that's interesting, and I'll put more of a write-up and locations of where it makes sense for you, but you can factor that the effect of this is going to be a function of how much humidity you have where you live. If you live in a place where there's a lot of humidity and it's really hot most of the time and there's nothing you can do but air conditioning, there are some choices. So here in the office, we have a window air conditioner that we just put in. In fact, we haven't finished sealing it all up. But this is a great option too. This runs on about 1,000 watts, right? So the evaporative cooler is 400. A big whole house AC is about 4,500. This is about 1,000 watts. And it'll cool a room like this pretty well. It keeps this whole entire office pretty cool. So even if you want to save money and still run air conditioning, think about putting one of these in rooms where you're sitting in more often, like an office during the day, or your bedroom at night. Because if you live upstairs, the heat rises and our bedroom is uninhabitable without one of these. So we just run this around 7 o'clock at night. That way it cools off by the time we go to bed and it's way cheaper than running the whole house AC.
And if you have to run your whole house AC, that's totally fine too. There are still things you can do. If you have time of use billing where electricity is cheaper at certain times of the day, what you could do is you could charge your house up by running air conditioning when it's cheapest. So for us, from midnight to 6 a.m., electricity is way cheaper. And so what you could do is you can program your thermostat to get crazy cold around that time. So when you wake up, your house is like freezing, which means your house stays comfortable longer into the day. It'll take longer for that heat to find its way in. And maybe you might find that you don't have to run the air conditioning again until after your peak hours. In fact, this entire office is running on solar and batteries thanks to our smart home panel from EcoFlow. So we have 14 kilowatt hours of storage and about 2,000 watts of solar that's coming in. Now this is temporary, it's just on the ground for now, but until we get up on the roof, I had solar panels laying around. I thought, let's just hook them up and start making energy. So this house hasn't been on the grid in days. So we can run the air conditioning all we want without any worry, which gets to one other point, which is if you want to stay cool and save money, get solar, right? Solar panels will keep your attic and your roof cooler, and they'll make so much energy that you can just run your AC and not worry about it. I can't wait for that because here in San Diego, our bills are so high and I've been paying $500 a month without air conditioning while it was cool. So I don't even want to think about how much money it will be when I have to run air conditioning. So I got to get solar as quickly as possible. All right, so in conclusion, air conditioning is always going to make sense for you depending on where you live. A evaporative cooler might make sense if you live in a dry desert kind of climate. The window film is pretty awesome. I think almost everybody could benefit from it depending on how comfortable you are installing it. And then a whole house fan makes sense if you have cool evenings. If after the sun goes down, it's cool outside where you live, a whole house fan can save you a ton of money. All right, I'm Ricky with Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching. Oh, and I just remembered, if you have a pool, just jump in. Easy way to stay cool.
I am cool, I'll tell you that.